your favorite cartoon characters will help you understand how drugs and alcohol can ruin your life. So watch the program. Talk about it with your family.
Welcome back to a special presentation with Mike and Ethan, or
Elf will not be seen tonight.
Hey, it's the first episode of our second season? Let's call it that.
Yeah, that's right. Year two.
Yes, year two of special presentation with Mike and Ethan, and now we're going to start experimenting and doing some things that are, well, I mean, we already started experimenting with this, with the whole Skywalker Kids thing, didn't we?
Yeah.
Where we're going to do things that are related to cartoons ancillarily, but are not necessarily based on comic strips. And today we are doing something that... if you could imagine it being successful, it would have been a very different world that we all grew up in.
God, I can't even imagine who this was made for, to be totally honest.
What it did was it sent me on this rabbit hole finding out what was going on with Mary Tyler Moore Productions. It's amazing to think that Mary Tyler Moore had once had such a stranglehold on our entire entertainment industry, and now it's just, you know, melted away like tears in the rain. But
well, you know what? Yeah, she's like that giant statue of Ozymandias in the desert, you know.
Yeah, and you look down at the head and it goes, meow!
Oh, Mimsy.
Yeah, it was very interesting looking at that and how, you know, you never knew what was going to turn out to be an MTM thing until you saw the kitten at the end.
I do remember as a child seeing that on so many. It was everything we watched as a kid either had that cat or the sit, boo-boo, sit. Good dog.
Or the... I don't remember what production company it was, but it had the guy playing the violin and his bow drew the S in the logo.
Oh, that's right. Oh,
they had that for Capital Critters, and there was an animated version for that too.
Yeah, there's also that one where the dude, he's like leaving an office at the end, and some woman says, "Good night, Mr. So and So," and he goes. I don't remember what production company that was either, though.
No.
Then there was the one where Spider-Man is on a logo. I remember that from the Muppet Babies.
Yeah. And that was before that there was the Mark 7. Dung!
Oh man, memories. But anyway, the reason we're talking about this is cuz tonight we watched Carlton, Your Doorman.
Now, to understand Carlton, Your Doorman, you have to understand that there was a popular show called Rhoda. And Rhoda itself was a spinoff of the Mary Tyler Moore show. But the thing that apparently the breakout character from Rhoda was the never seen, face never shown on the show, Doorman, who ran the door... I guess. You know, I didn't know what a doorman did until I watched this.
I guess they open doors in fancy buildings. That's their thing.
It looks from this like he also puts their mail in their mailboxes and I guess does other random stuff like walk dogs.
I think it must be a New York thing because I've never seen anything like this.
Yeah, he dresses like what I would call a bellhop, but...
Yeah. The reason I think that he was such a breakout character on Rhoda was he is voiced by Lorenzo Music, a Garfield.
Yes. And like I said, can you imagine a world where Carlton, Your Doorman had been a slam dunk hit and Here Comes Garfield had just passed into the wind?
I imagine. So this was from 1980. So yes. Can you imagine that if this was a hit, Lorenzo Music would have been so busy doing this that he never would have voiced Garfield. And we would probably get one of those other people who auditioned, possibly Sterling Holloway.
Sterling Holloway? Oh, that's my right. God.
I looked it up, and apparently he was one of the guys who auditioned for Garfield's voice.
I'm trying to imagine that. Sterling Holloway. It's like, okay, let's see. What's a Garfield line? Hello, I'm Garfield. I'm a cat, and this is my cartoonist, John. Our only thought is to entertain you. Feed me!
See, it sounds like, can you imagine the, wow. This seems like a Rick and Morty bit where they just watch, like, alternative TV, and they're like, yeah, in this universe, Sterling Holloway plays Garfield. Give me my, I'm Gazorpa Zorpa Field. Give me my goddamn lasagna.
Enchiladas.
Yeah. Enchiladas, that's it. Yeah. Sorry. Right. I don't have a high enough IQ to remember Rick and Morty bits correctly.
Let's try it again. Okay, Garfield, voiced by Peter Lorre. You know what I like about Odie? He's so push-offable.
You know what? Actually, that would be good. That would be 100% amazing if Garfield was Peter Lorre, voiced by Peter Lorre.
Now for a really hard one. Garfield is voiced by Hans Conride.
Oh.
More trainloads of food! Airdrop food into my mouth! More cattle! Hurry! I'm hungry!
It's good, but it's a lot less sexy.
Yeah. Then the Lorenzo Music doing... I guess he never did read that one out loud, did he?
No, but at least he's got kind of a husky voice that you're like, oh,
there
my...
is that.
Like, you can kind of hear... Like, I bet Lorenzo Music was pretty good at pillow talk because he's just got that naturally salty voice. Sultry, not salty voice.
Well, he does. I think the natural salt in his voice is why they hired him for Garfield.
That's true. I mean, apparently, Jim Davis said that they were doing auditions and Lorenzo Music basically did one line read and he was like, that's the guy.
That's him.
Yeah, when Jim Davis was saying, like, oh, there's this big room of people who audition, and I saw Lorenzo Music in the corner licking himself. So I guess he knew that he had sensibilities. But the fact that Carlton the Doorman was an unseen character on Rhoda seems to, I think, have inspired Lorenzo Music's career-long camera shyness, where he does that running gag where you never see his face no matter what.
Yeah, even in, like, you know, production stuff that never is supposed to never leave the company, these are people to here, secretary, don't card these people. They work here. You know, he'll still have a photo taken with a Garfield mask on or something like that.
Yeah. And it's funny because there is a photo of him that I saw on Wikipedia and He's a normal looking guy. He looks a lot like Cheech Marin, to be honest. But
a little bit, yeah. He's just a bald middle aged man. He looks like Bram from Sharon Lois and Bram.
Yeah, I can see that. You know, and he's but he's not a bad looking guy.
No, no, not at all. I'm sure he was getting tons of trim in the '70s.
Yeah, yeah. But anyway, I think we're probably going to talk a lot about Lorenzo Music. And then should we talk about him first, or should we talk about Carlton, the doorman?
Yeah, let's talk about Carlton.
Okay.
Now, yeah, the Carlton special seems to be do you think it's a pilot, or do you think it's just a special?
I think it was a pilot. It says, what I read is it was an unsold pilot.
Unsold? So
they thought that this would be a thing. They made this in hopes that... Yes, here it is. According to Wikipedia, Music co-produced and co-wrote a 1980 animated special called Carlton, Your Doorman, which won an Emmy Award because it's so good. And though it was actually a pilot episode, CBS did not pick it up as a series.
Wow. That's weird to think that he wrote this. I have to wonder if maybe it is an unsold pilot. It was because they only had one person that they were trying to sell it to. I'm just imagining Lorenz are like, okay, what do you want in this special? And he's like, I want to see the molested dead dog.
Yes, someone who's really into that necrobestiality.
I mean, I wonder if I was watching the things with the Shaftmans, and I was wondering if they were a caricature of somebody real. Maybe that's who Mr. Shaftman is, the whoever it was at CBS they were trying to sell this to.
Yeah, he does have that that feel where they do that where they're like, this is very funny if you work at the CBS headquarters, but you know, so this is the special. It feels extremely, well, it is 1980, so it makes sense. Yes. It does feel extremely 70s.
Yeah, it's the Carter 80s, the very short-lived Carter 80s.
It's that got that kind of like every, it's animated with that kind of loosey-goosey keep on trucking look. It's not quite Ralph Bakshi, but has a little bit of that style to it.
No, it's directed by Fred Wolf, which is why you'll probably recognize it as resembling Free to Be You and Me.
Oh, yeah, I'd say so. So that
and also that. And The Point, if you've ever seen that one.
Yes, I do remember that. That one was about how, that was that cartoon about how war is bad, right? Or is it racism?
Among other things, I think the same people did the video for the one about Peace on Earth Is All It Said.
Oh, One Tin Soldier?
One Tin Soldier, yes.
Yeah, I remember having to sing that in middle school music class. And I remember at the time, I was like, well, I remember it's like, oh, really? The real treasure, the friends we made along the way.
Well, we had to sing, oh, God. You know what? We had to sing an awful lot of songs that they never actually gave me any lyrics for, so I just had to kind of mouth along and listen to the others and gradually get line by line. And,
yeah, I remember. It
feels like ADHD writ large.
I remember that we had to sing that one. We had to sing, we actually sang great Dies Irae. My middle school music teacher was extremely into Gregorian chant, which was, I'm sure we were supposed to learn something through that, but
that was about when that big chant CD came out, didn't it?
Yeah, the Funky Monks.
Yeah.
Or whatever they were called. I don't know. Like Enigma, right?
Something like that. All I remember is that, you know, the greeting card artist, oh crap, what's her name? The one who did I forget her name, but she did a whole parody of it with barnyard animals called Grunt.
I did not know that actually.
Yeah, and the pigs were all singing in pig Latin.
Oh, that's actually kind of clever.
It is pretty funny, yeah.
Probably funnier than Carlton the Doorman.
Yeah, Carlton your Doorman is not good. It is a I watched this with a group of my friends, and I do this a lot. I try and get other people's reactions when I watch these, and it was just universally negative. They said, this makes me feel wrong and bad. This gives me a yucky feeling in my stomach.
Yeah. I watched this alone. And my reaction was just complete indifference. I like, there was no like bump in my biorhythms watching this. Yeah. And even now I'm having trouble. I literally watched it 20 minutes ago and I'm already having trouble remembering what happened. but I think it starts with a car. So actually it's weird. There are two theme songs in this because it starts out with this kind of funky beat. You know?
Yeah,
like blah, 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 blah. And then and they do this whole thing where Carlton is getting dressed, but you don't see his face, and it's now it seems just kind of, it doesn't stick out now, but I'm sure at the time people were like, oh my God, we're gonna see Carlton's face. We're gonna see Carlton, my doorman's face. I can't believe we're actually gonna see it.
I can't believe it's what does Carlton look like? What is Carlton? Oh, he just looks like Zonker.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the thing is, like, I've never watched Rhoda, so I guess I can't be disappointed. But, like, so watching it, I was kind of like, yeah, that fits. I mean, he kind of looks like an old hippie. I mean, his voice sounds like an old hippie. So so it is the look that would fit the character.
Yeah.
So it's not like when they reveal Dr. Claw's face in that action figure and everyone's like, what?
Boring.
Yeah, it's like, why did you do that? But Carlton, your doorman, he is, I guess the plot is that he is your doorman, and
yes.
He works at a building where he answers the door, and the man who owns the building is, well, you know what? I mean, if you're gonna make a cartoon, it's like, and there's a guy who owns a building, it's gonna be this guy.
Yeah.
He's like a little short, fat guy with a big cigar.
Yeah. His name was Mr. Shaftman. Well, the first time I heard it, I was like, yeah. Mr. Shadman? You mean like the pedo artist?
Every time they said his voice, I just kept hearing, "Oh, Mr. Sheffield," you know, from The Nanny. But
so,
yeah.
Yeah.
But he's mad at Zonker for not showing up to work on time. And yeah. They do a lot of that, like, kind of sitcom banter that's not really very funny. I mean, it's like, it's that weird thing where it's like you see, like, oh, that's kind of clever, yet entirely not funny.
But it must have been funny. Did you hear how the audience was reacting?
Oh, that's right. This was animated before a live studio audience. So it is, apparently this was one of the last animated things to have a laugh track, according to Wikipedia, my source on all things, which is interesting when you realize that prior to this, that was normal. Like every cartoon that had any sort of adult demographic, they added a laugh track in, because the Flintstones had it. Yep. Laugh Olympics, I think, had it.
Laugh Olympics?
Yeah, which is like, which shows an incredible lack of faith in the title right there. I think Scooby-Doo even had it.
Laugh Olympics should have had like a roaring crowd laughing if they could have done that.
That would have been a lot better. I mean, that would have been at least sort of thematic. But yeah, I don't know.
The Muppet Show had a laugh track. I mean,
yeah.
And it kind of ruins the Muppet Show. But actually, you know, one of the best ones is the one where they send the audience home because it's actually the day that they interview new acts. So you get the whole show with no laugh track, and it's actually really good.
Oh, wow.
Helps there's the Steve Martin episode.
Oh, well, yeah. It is funny how that was just such, I mean, the culture of America was such that was just a normal thing. And I guess
people don't know when to laugh.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it's weird because I guess the theory is that, like, oh, if you hear laughter, you know there's a joke, and it'll make it seem funnier because we are, you know, social animals, and we yes. tend to mimic emotions of other people. Now, I actually, it's funny because I actually, when I was younger, I attended I was in a live studio audience at one point.
Oh, really?
Yes, I went to a live taping of Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Oh, lucky.
Yeah, and the thing is, and actually, if you ever see the episode, you can see me, because I am right behind Drew Carey. So
oh,
not
wow.
the good version, I'm in the American
oh.
version.
Oh, well.
But the thing is, like they said to me, they said, look, not me specifically, my group, you're right behind Drew Carey, you're going to be on screen a lot, so you have to like laugh your asses off, you have to like really like act like everything is funny or we're gonna move you. And we're just like, oh, we want to be on TV, so we better play along.
Wow.
And you know, at first it was okay because, you know, it's not super funny, but like you can pretend. But this taping lasted 2 hours, and
I always wondered how much they cut out of a given episode.
Yeah, it turns out those guys are actually not nearly as good at improv as they make it appear. So
yeah.
They redo things a lot. And by the end, we're just like, kill me. I can't do this anymore.
I do remember that on the good version, there were plenty of episodes where it wasn't really live. It was just Clive Anderson would show up and say that here are a lot of scenes from last season that we didn't get to show off because we had to cut time for advertisements. And that was so, yeah, there was a lot that we didn't see that only ended up in the collective episodes.
Yeah. But so I assume that means that like when they say live studio audience, that is actually true. There are actually people there. They just tell them to laugh, you know?
Yes.
And, cause as a kid, I just assumed they just had a machine. They pushed a button. Now, since this is a cartoon, it must be a machine pushing a button, cause they don't have people, unless they have people just standing around looking at still frames. I don't know what they would do there.
That would be funny. Well, I mean, it could be that they show the final version and then record the laughter from a big theater audience or something. But
that's true.
That wouldn't be live.
Yeah. 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 So I don't know. I'm not sure how they do this. But there is a laugh track, and it's very controlled. It doesn't sound, you don't get a lot of lingering laughs in there. So it does sound like it's probably the same laugh just used over and over.
Yeah. I am really glad this tradition died out.
Yeah.
I mean, not just because our generation are so used to there not being one, but yeah, I think, you know, there was still a lot of it when we were watching TV as kids, because there were so many old reruns, things like MASH and, wait, MASH didn't have it, did it? I don't remember.
But I mean, most of the
Happy Days definitely did. That was what I hated about Happy Days.
I mean, yeah, because the sitcoms into the 80s had them. I remember Cheers and Alf and all those ones had laugh tracks.
Alf had a laugh track, but I think Cheers had a live audience.
Oh, that's true. Hey, so I wonder, so when did sitcoms stop using them? Because I know that they started doing kind of more high-end prestige comedies that don't use them. But when did your average, what do you call it, two-camera or three-camera sitcom stop using the laugh track?
They still have the live studio audience. I mean, the Connors, I think, is filmed before a live audience. But what I'm thinking of, the prestige one, the first one I can think of is Malcolm in the Middle.
Mm. Yeah, that would be, you're right, that would be a pretty early one that didn't have it. Hey, did Seinfeld have a laugh track?
Yeah, it had a live studio, I think.
Okay, it did. So, maybe, okay. Yeah. All right. But yeah, so
I feel like Friends must have had a laugh track rather than a live studio audience.
So Carlton, Your Doorman is from 1980. So apparently animation did away with the laugh track long before live action did, because live action is still doing it into the 90s. Now, Carlton, the story is that Mr. Shaftman, he wants Carlton to walk his dog, but his extremely horny wife wants to get it on with Carlton. So she's always, throwing herself at him.
Now, if you want to do the voice of Mrs. Shaftman, it's easy. Just speak while inhaling. Oh, Carlton, I really want to jump your bones.
She's basically Mrs. Bighead.
She's Mercedes McCambridge. Fuck me! Fuck me!
She's very excited about, getting with Carlton. And Carlton is not interested in her.
About this point that I realized that there was literally no one in this cartoon that I liked.
Yeah, I actually thought it was kind of weird that Carlton, the character, again, I don't know anything about the Carlton as he was portrayed on Rhoda.
Yeah.
Other than apparently he's a drinker, so he's supposed to always be drunk or something.
Yeah, I didn't recognize that he was supposed to be drunk, but I guess the only real TV drunk I'm familiar with is Barney Gumble.
Yeah. And that's the thing is Barney Gumble is probably a little more accurate, because it's being an alcoholic is kind of not nearly as lovable as Carlton makes it seem. The thing is, they portray him. It's kind of weird, apparently, because Mrs.
Shaftman,
Mrs. Crankshaft says to says to him like, "Oh, you've been macking on every woman in the building." And he's like, "Who told you that?" And she's like, "Every woman in the building." And it's like, it's just weird, because it's like, oh, I find it very hard to. It doesn't. It seems weird that Carlton is also a big horn dog. It feels like he should be kind of almost a Shaggy type character or Jughead, who just likes drinking.
So you want him to be Garfield but with beer?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, maybe that's why I kept thinking that, because because it is Garfield's voice. So I'm like, why yes. is he? Why is he interested in women? I don't understand.
He's supposed to be devoted to his stomach or liver above all.
Yeah. Anyway, so he goes up to Mrs. Gearshaft, and she's all like, take my dog, the dog for a walk. Right.
Yeah.
So he does that.
Meets his mom in the park. His mom is a bag lady.
His mom is she's a bag lady.
Yeah, she's like a professional like trash picker or something.
Huh.
And her running gag is that she keeps giving him one of something that you're supposed to have two of. And I found her the most likable character.
Yeah, I mean she's not offensive in any way. I mean, I should say she doesn't offend me in the sense that I dislike her. I suppose she may be offensive to, you know, houseless people to see that done as a gag. I was actually surprised because when he first, in the beginning, he's like, oh, hi, mom. I thought, oh, this is going to be like a once off joke. But apparently, like, no, that was planned to be a thing in this show, that his mom is, I guess, is she homeless? What is going on
there?
Well,
she lives with him. So that's
Okay.
Her not having a job, I guess.
Oh, okay. I couldn't tell if she actually lived with, I thought that she just lived in the, I thought she lived in the trash and her like shitty, ungrateful son didn't. He just let her live there while he lived inside a house.
I mean, knowing Carlton, I can believe that very easily, but it seems like he at least somewhat takes care of her, since he takes her out to dinner with his girlfriend at the end.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Oh, he's also got a cat.
Yeah, the cat's name is Ringo, and I thought he was a raccoon at first.
Yeah, he's got the ring tails. Probably why they call him Ringo.
Ringo.
Yeah, they do that thing like when Carlton puts his pants on, he accidentally puts Ringo in his pants, so Ringo sticks his head out of the fly and the laugh track goes crazy. I guess that was
like, oh my god, pants have flies.
I mean, it's like, wow. It's just one of those things where it's like you realize when listening to a laugh track, it's like, oh, it's just not good.
You're faking it.
Yeah.
Not even faking it on a Man Harry Met Sally level.
Yeah. It's just, they're not even trying. But
this
anyway.
Is all in the winter time, by the way. You notice it's another, you know, snowy New York cityscape. I was wondering if maybe this is a Christmas special.
Oh, maybe.
Didn't really come up though.
No. Well, you know how it is. Like New York is always New York in the winter. It's always a,
yep.
God.
Like they said in Gila Monsters Meet You at the Airport, back east it snows and blows all the time except for 5 minutes when it's spring and summer.
Also, you know, they're alligators in the sewers. Sometimes they meet you at the airport.
I read it in a book, so I know it's so.
What a classic. I remember that one.
I think I actually once went to an airport and they had a little Gila monster display. So that was nice.
Nice. They were all like, okay, well, we need something that's airport themed. So we're going to go with that. I remember that book and reading that book and being like, wait a minute, it's Gila monster. Oh, I've been saying it wrong this whole time. Like a sap. So
yeah. Gila monsters and gorned toads.
Yeah, I, you know, so then I had to be explained to me it's a Spanish G. It's like, oh, okay.
It isn't a G too. Yeah, I was not just the J. That's right.
Oh, is it a J? I think it's yeah.
No, it's a G. I was trying to remember if in Spanish you pronounce the G harder or aspirated like in Jorge.
Oh, but yeah. I guess it is also like an H. Anyway, Carlton the doorman. So Carlton, your doorman. I'm sorry.
Yes. Oh no, you can have him.
According to this show, I own Carlton. It's just like my wait a second. If it's like people always say like My Little Pony. Well, does that indicate that I own that pony? But Carlton, your doorman, indicates that I don't own Carlton. He's always owned by someone else. I, by definition, can't own him because he is your doorman. However, My Little Pony, I always own because it's my... Okay, I'm sorry. This is getting stupid.
I don't every know. Single I just person like the tuned idea. In
has just been like, okay, that's enough. We're turning this off.
We've I lost like our the entire thought of audience. Having an entire toy line of doormen, and they all have, you know, they all have beautiful flowing epaulets that you can comb.
Well, you know, he does have nice hair in this.
Yeah.
He's got
he's not an unattractive cartoon character.
Yeah. He's got that kind of like skinny hippie look. Yeah, very, very shaggy or yeah. You know, Rincewind, I guess. I don't know why I thought of Rincewind as the archetypical cartoon hippie sort of guy, because he's like A, not a cartoon, and B, not a hippie.
We're talking from
Discworld.
Okay. For a second, I thought Rincewind was for something way lower rent, like some D&D series or something.
No. I think just the way they draw him sometimes kind of looks like a hippie. I think that's why I thought of it.
Yeah, they tend to draw him with like an Amish beard, don't they?
Yeah, they do. Okay, so Carlton is walking a dog.
Yes, the dog's name is Punkin, and he's, he's just a cartoon dog. That's the thing, is that we're supposed to be, you know, angry about the dog, about what a mean dog he is, but he's just a dog. Barely anthropomorphize him.
Yeah, you're right, he's just a dog, and he doesn't even do the Muttley thing, you know?
You know, he doesn't laugh. Yeah, he doesn't laugh at anyone's jokes. He just, you know, he just wants to go for his walk because he's a dog, and then he has a heart attack and dies.
I love comedy. I love to laugh. I know, it was kind of like when that happened, I was like, what? Okay.
We do get one very brief moment of the dog clutching his chest and panicking and trying to call to Carlton before slumping back dead instantly. So it had like an embolism or something. And jeez. It's like, this is awful.
I mean, this, different.
You know that Far Side cartoon where the lady has braced her dog door shut and she's calling, here, Fifi, come on, faster, Fifi.
Yeah.
That's different. That's funny. That is actually, that is entertaining. I mean, maybe, you know, Gary Larson assumed, probably correctly, that most of the civilized world hates little rat-sized dogs named Fifi. And, you know, that's... But the joke here is that this woman is being incredibly cruel. But the only cruelty here is on the part of God. This dog just dies trying to keep up with Carlton as he macks on a woman at the park.
Yeah. Like, I'd also argue the Far Side cartoon is funny because it is so surreal. You're like, this woman owns a dog, yet somehow...
This is her own dog.
This is her own dog, but somehow she's just like, I'm going to do this thing to it. And it's so bizarre and nonsensical that it kind of becomes funny. Whereas, like, when you watch Carlton the Doorman, the dog dies, it's like, oh, yeah, the capriciousness of life. That's not funny. That could be me. That will be me someday. This dog has reminded me of my own mortality. I don't like it.
Memento Carlton.
Yeah, it's like, oh, this is terrible. Like literally, like, the dog will be like, as I am, you will be. So
it harks back, harks forward a little bit to Diana's Piano, because again, it's not like a cartoon dog. I mean, it is a cartoon dog, but at the same time, it's only portrayed as a dog who is you know, as innocent as any dog. And I'm not even that big a fan of dogs, but I still felt really terrible for Punkin.
Yeah.
He basically dies alone. And
he's it's like, oh, I can't believe this. Cause we're supposed to be like this rotten dog. I can't believe he made Carlton take him outside just so he could take a shit. Stupid dog. Why does he have to poop? Yeah,
Carlton did make a pretty good joke there at the beginning when he gets the note from Mrs. Stiveman that Punkin's in the bathroom. Come and get him. And Carl's like, well, if he's in the bathroom, why do I have to take him for a walk?
Yeah, I'll credit where it's due. There are a couple of lines in this thing that are actually pretty amusing. And I noticed
my favorite is the one where he's trying to explain how Punkin died. And he's like, he just went like, and he can't snap. He went really fast.
Yeah. Like, it's funny. The funniest jokes in this are the ones that don't seem like, the ones that feel incidental.
Yeah. The ones that don't get the big laugh track.
Yeah.
You know what it's like? It's like Popeye.
Yeah.
You know, because, you know, Popeye says incredibly funny things under his breath that you have to really be listening for.
You're right. You know, that actually reminds me. I was listening to or reading a thing by, there's a comedian called Stuart Lee. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about tricks of stand-up comedy. And apparently there's a thing in stand-up comedy where you tell a joke, and then after the joke, you say the joke, and then you say, like, and but you kind of pause there. And the point of it is, if you pause at the punchline for the laugh, the audience is like, oh, you're straining for a laugh, we're not going to do it. But if you add and, it sounds like you're just going to continue on, and that the joke you made was just kind of a throwaway incidental thing. And that somehow makes the whole thing funnier. And so that might be the principle that's going on here, that these jokes just feel funnier because this cartoon is not like rubbing our noses into them.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah, any joke that I'm supposed to jump to my feet for feels less funny.
Yeah, because, like, you know, the ones where they're the big laughs, we're like, oh, we're like, you know, the cat in the pants, we're like, oh, that's a big set piece. We really need to notice that. But, like, you know, it's just it kind of falls flat, like a lot of things in this. But a few of the little, like, the little bits kind of land. Though, like, there are some weird ones. Go on.
No, you go on. Go on.
I was gonna say, there's some weirdness in this, like when Punkin dies, and that woman comes up and she's like, "What a well-behaved dog!" And Carlton's like, "He's dead." It's like,
and she pulls her hand away and goes, "Ew."
It was so strange, because it's like, you kind of had a joke there, but I guess you wanted to make it serious, so you have that line about the dog being dead, which just kind of seems weird, because, like, Carlton, would you really just be like, the dog's dead? It's like, you could just, like, let the lady believe you have a well-behaved dog. You don't have to ruin her day, too.
Yeah. And I mean, it's... And her reaction is not like, oh my God, you poor thing, you've lost your dog. It's like, ew, a poor person with a dead animal.
Yeah, seriously. Maybe it's a New York thing, you know?
What a bitch.
Because, weird. But then Carlton has to get a replacement dog. So
yeah. Oh, and he goes to a pet cemetery, and he gets Punkin buried for $20.
I know. And they're acting like that's so much money.
The kingly sum of $20. I mean, the kid could have gotten that poor lab cat buried easily and not had to sneak into the pet cemetery.
Yeah. Well, apparently, apparently $20 is like an exorbitant sum back then in 1980.
In 1980?
I don't know. Well, Carlton acts like it is, so I'm kind of like confused. I don't know.
And then he gets paid $3 for walking Punkin, so I wonder what that's like.
Mm. When is actually Carlton the Doorman supposed to take place? Is it supposed to take place in 1980?
I don't see any sign that it would have been any other time. It's a relatively up-to-date buzzer system with the intercoms and everything.
Right,
I think.
Right.
I mean,
as far as I can tell.
Yeah, I've never lived in an apartment building, so I wouldn't know, but...
Yeah. I mean, I have, and they kind of looked like that. I mean, but it has been a long time, so I don't know.
Yeah, but you didn't have a doorman.
No, we did not have a doorman. We weren't that upscale.
All I know doormen from are this and, like, Super Fudge, where they have a doorman who's their friend, and...
Hmm.
And Fudge tells him where babies come from. And
oh, yeah, I don't remember seeing doormen in anything else. I mean, I think I've seen them. I think I've seen them in cartoons. You know?
Yeah, it seems like one of those things that happens a lot more in cartoons. Like, I don't know. First thing I thought of was wacky penguins, but that probably happens a lot when we're not looking.
Yeah. Like, I mean, I can't think of a specific instance, but I'm sure there must have been like some cartoon where Bugs Bunny wants to get into a building and some like really like buff doorman with giant like ape arms and tiny little feet won't let him in.
Yes.
You know,
one of Chuck Jones's lummoxes. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that just seems like a very classic Bugs Bunny thing to happen. So if there is no such cartoon, then I mean, really, Chuck Jones, what is that? How can you let that perfect opportunity slip between your fingers?
Chuck Jones is canceled, man.
Yeah, seriously. Chuck Jones is too busy drawing Tom's eyebrows to like notice that he's missing out on all the good Bugs Bunny antagonist situations.
Not only that, this is the same afternoon, but Punkin is already buried with a gravestone that says Punkin. Do you think that they pre-make pet tombstones with all of the basic pet names? Here lies Flopsy. Here lies Rover.
Man, I mean, I feel like nowadays they do pre-make a lot of tombstones that have pictures of pets on them. I think names are, I mean, they're so wacky with pets that like, how are you going to predict if people are going to name their pets? People come in with things like named Cosmic Creepers or something, you know?
Don't you know a cat has three different names?
You know, that's true.
The everyday name like Boo Boo or something, and then his real name is, you know, Master Disaster Ultra Peace the Fourth or something like that.
Yeah.
And then there's the third name that only the cat knows.
I think it's like if you go to the pet cemetery and you're like, okay, I'm looking for tombstone that says Bort. It's like, I'm so, what? Talking to my cat? No, my cat is also named Bort. but anyway, he does not. So then he goes to look for more dogs, and he tries.
Yes, because he can't just say, your dog died of a heart attack on his walk. I'm so sorry. He has to find a replacement for Punkin. So he goes to the pound?
Yeah, he goes to the pound, and he cannot find a dog that's right, but. But before he leaves, he pulls the master switch to release all the dogs.
Do you think that that's a thing?
I do not think that is a thing at all. I think that most pounds probably have normal doors with locks on them. You know, I think they were just like, well, we can't animate Carlton unlocking every door, so we're just going to have this switch here that he pulls.
I wonder if maybe it's a fire code thing. Like you have to be able to make sure these animals can get free, and they're not going to put it way in the back where you have to put yourself into danger. So, you know, if you ever have to flee the building, well, it should have at least been like under glass you had to break or something.
Okay. You know, you might be right on that actually. Now that I think about it, because it would be very difficult to unlock every cage in the event of a fire. But anyway, so we finally know that it is Carlton who has let the dogs out.
You can shut up now, Bahaman. God. Yeah,
you're welcome. so then he goes to a pet store. And
yeah, there's a pet store, and there's a old man with a parrot.
Being
and they
sassy.
Have a dog that looks exactly like Punkin.
Yeah, but it turns out it's already been sold.
Yes, it's already been sold to a person who's basically the human equivalent of Punkin.
Yeah.
So.
But it's funny because then comes one of the, what I thought was actually the best line in the whole special, where the guy says, we have another one that looks like him. And Carlton's like, well, I want to see that. And the guy brings it out and it's a puppy. And Carlton's like, oh, it's a puppy. And the store owner says, yeah, that's how we get them from the mothers. Which I thought was probably the funniest thing they say in the entire entire animation, because it's just so deadpan.
The parrot makes a couple of one-liners too, but as Carlton is excusing himself, the shop owner's like, how about a parrot? And the parrot says, "How about an old man?" Hey, shut up.
That was kind of amusing. But anyway, he finally, unable to find another dog, Carlton decides that he's going to transform his cat into a dog.
Yes, and takes his cat, poor Ringo, to his girlfriend, the hairdresser, the hair butcher, as Mrs. Shaftman called her.
Yeah.
And that's like, you know, not only did you kill a dog, and intentionally or not, but now you were being cruel to your very own cat. Our hero.
Yeah, the cat goes through, I can only imagine, traumatic hair changes, but also it appears to be like they somehow give it a dog snout, and
I don't know how they did that.
they twist the tail in a way that you cannot twist a cat's tail. They do not like that, but it's a cartoon, so whatever.
Yeah, I immediately thought of the cartoon where George Licker puts a rubber band over Ren's tail, and it immediately turns black and falls off.
Ugh. Yeah. So this whole thing is not good, but I thought it was kind of weird because we do see Carlton's girlfriend in this, right? And she's supposed to be hot because, you know, she's
a hot woman.
Because
she has visible nipples.
Yeah. Yeah. I wanted to mention that there are visible nipples, and it's like, okay. That seems a little risque from 1980 network television, but, you know.
Remember what I said about the Fantastic Funnies and how it's, you know, a specifically 70s kind of horny?
Yes.
I've learned that there was a word for that. They were called the Jiggle Shows.
Really?
Yes, you can look it up. Look up Jiggle Shows on Wikipedia. It has a big list of all these shows that were just about putting women in tight clothing and having them bounce around.
God, can you imagine, I mean, living in a world before you had easy 24 access to pornography?
Yeah.
I mean, and people would people are going to tune in and see, like, you know, a woman in, like, a Hooters uniform and just, like, completely lose their minds. You know, just be like, just literally, like, going and, like, seeing a nipple poking through fabric and just reacting like a cartoon wolf in a Tex Avery short. You know, like seriously, what a world.
And we got that same thing from the woman that Carlton was chasing when Pumpkin died too. Did you see the way she had very animated jiggle going on?
I did notice that. I was thinking, like, it's like they're doing some Studio Clamp jiggling there, because they really animate that. She does not have visible nipples, but they do have jiggle, and she's wearing like the really short, like, you know, what do you call? What are they called? We were talking about this the other day.
Really short what?
The shorts.
Pants?
Yeah, short little. Shorts? Yeah. Well, I know that short pants are called shorts, but really short, like track shorts. That's it.
Track shorts. Yes.
Because remember, we were discussing this in with our crowd, and someone apparently in jolly old Blighty, they call them baggies.
Baggies.
Yeah.
I've heard baggies used, but it's usually means you swim trunks.
Oh, okay. God. You don't even know what you're getting. But anyway, she's drawn that way. Because it is, again, it's a very 70s thing where you're like, oh yeah, tight shirts, really kind of hot pants type things. That's the look back then.
It's just like, it feels like they were so close to inventing Mormon bubble porn.
Yeah, man. I can't, it's sad that we are as with the rise of, you know, the insane religious fascism that's taking over this country, with all its, with the increasing clampdown on adult material, that we're going to re-enter the age of jiggle shows, because it'll once again be our only sexual outlet.
I don't think so. I think that they've recognized by now that having a sexual outlet tamps down the tendency for revolution.
Mm. Well, you know, it worked for a while. But we'll see. We'll
We'll
see.
see.
We'll
Yes.
see. Anyway, so would this be a jiggle show? I mean,
Yeah, I mean, there should have been more women in it to make it a real jiggle show, but you can see the influences of the jiggle show on this one, I would say.
So Carlton's nipply girlfriend helps him turn his cat into a dog, and
Yes.
he brings a
The cat
dog.
does look just like Pumpkin, which is, of course, not difficult because it is a cartoon.
So he brings the dog back to Miss
Shaftman.
Shaftman,
I'm
and
sorry, did I cut you off in the middle of thinking of something funny?
no. I was legitimately trying to remember her name that time. Mrs. Shaftman.
Yes.
And they she does the like, oh, Rocco thing,
Yeah.
and but then Ringo like meows and gives the game away, and
Oh, and she
it
has sardines just sitting out on a big open plate.
maybe was that a thing back
Was
then?
gonna say, is that a rich people thing? I guess.
Maybe. Well,
I don't know.
rich people do like eating extremely stupid foods, so
Yeah.
maybe.
I just think of sardines as something you eat when you're riding on a in a train with hobos
Yeah, honestly, same.
after escaping from Andy.
Oh, I really hope Simone gets to France.
So yeah, he finally has to admit after being marched to the door that he's killed or allowed Pumpkin to die, and Mrs. Shaffman is hammering him with her weak, skinny old lady fists at just as Mr. Shaffman steps in, and she says, and she's telling him, "Fire him, kill him."
And it's like, oh no, Carlton's really in a pickle this time. How is
Oh
that
no.
Carlton gonna get out of it?
What's going to happen? Is Carl going to actually face consequences for his dangerous incompetence?
Well, what it's well, I bet you were pretty surprised by how it turned out. I bet you were completely blindsided. Like, you not a million years did you guess this twist that came up next.
Yeah. Mr.
Where
Shaftman is an asshole who hated his own dog.
Yeah, it's like who would have predicted? But except that happens, and literally every time in a cartoon when someone kills someone else's animal, that happens. Well, they mentioned though the dog was like 19, so it's like
Yeah, there's a
that's
very old
pretty,
dog.
yeah,
Yeah.
that's extremely old for a dog. So I mean they kind of should have been expecting it,
Yeah.
but it is funny that, like, apparently, I wonder if they're now completely unconcerned with the fact that their dog is buried somewhere and they have no clue where.
I don't know. I wonder if maybe Punkin already had, they'd already had a gravestone made for
Do you
him.
think that it was all prepaid and then the Carlton just had to show up?
And pay his own money for.
Oh, you're right.
Oh man, what an asshole funeral director. He charges people for stuff that's prepaid.
He's skimming a little off the side, apparently. So anyway, then Carlton and the Shad Man go to get drinks together, and
Yes.
that's kind of the end, I think.
And then, is this something, did this taste really white privilege-y to you?
Oh, in the sense that it's about like rich white people in a building who have their own doorman.
Yeah, I mean, can you imagine what would have happened to Carlton if he'd been black?
Oh yeah, that's true. Carlton would. I don't think he would. I think that this would have turned out very different.
Yes.
But man, it is. God.
But he sees no consequences and is allowed, nay, encouraged to continue drinking himself to death.
Yes. It's funny that they were like, oh yeah, can I come? He's like, it's funny that Mr. Shaftman is all like, you gotta be in on time, but it's okay if you're drunk the whole time. It's like, okay. I mean, all right. Weird flex, but okay. So I mean, I can kind of see why CBS was like, no, we'll pass.
Yeah. But don't feel bad for the MTM company. They had lots and lots of stuff on the way.
Yes. So they had about a million shows.
A freaking gazillion. After this, things you might have actually heard of, including Hill Street Blues, Remington Steel, St. Elsewhere, The Duck Factory. Well, you probably never heard of that one.
I have heard of The Duck Factory. I remember those little
cartoon
ducks.
Yeah, it ran on Comedy Central.
Yeah. I remember the little ducks in the bumpers.
Yes.
Nothing else.
And of course, Fresno, which was a parody. Yes. Mary Tyler Moore Productions made a miniseries called Fresno that was a parody of primetime shows like Falcon Crest and Dallas and Dynasty.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes. So it was about a couple of wealthy raisin farmers in Fresno.
Was it any good?
I've never seen it.
Huh. We've been watching Falcon Crest, actually. What very interesting we've learned about like old soap operas is, first of all, people spend all their time drinking coffee, like constantly in these things. Like everyone's going over to each other's houses to like make announcements. And they're like, do you want some coffee? Yes, some coffee, please. Oh, good. And it's all, you know, it's funny because, of course, everyone is drinking just that shitty instant coffee, which was the only thing that you had back in the 80s, you know, before the rise of Starbucks. And also,
so have you liked coffee long?
Yeah, it's like, oh, you know, let's talk about coffee. Oh,
where is it, your coffee?
Show it to me. Bring it here. The other thing is I like how every soap opera has like that one asshole character who instigates shit constantly. But they're like, you know, but it's like they come over and they say like, oh, yeah, your husband is cheating on you. And it's like, and everyone's like, I can't believe that. I'm going to go divorce him now. And it's like, well, this person is lying. They lie constantly. That's what they do. Why do you believe them? You know they're a liar.
Wow, soaps are so much more like Saturday morning cartoons. It's like, oh, great. We had to have a Reggie Mantle on this show.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, I guess when you think about it, the art forms aren't that different.
No.
Got to keep people tuning in. But anyway, sorry. Well, I was derailing onto Falcon Crest because I know we're also everyone listening is like, oh, I want to hear more about Falcon Crest. Well, I really want to know how that Angela Channing gets out of this one. Is she actually going to buy Westman Wines, or will Cole Giovanni defeat her this time? Anyway,
they never have any laser fights on these soap shows.
No, with a name like Falcon Crest, you would expect it, but nope.
Yeah, Falcon Crest sounds like a superhero team.
Yeah, it's like turns out no, it's not. But anyway, so Mary Tyler Moore, like you said, they do a lot of stuff.
Oh, man, stuff that I had no association with them. America's Funniest Home Videos.
Really? Huh.
Yeah.
So
Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman.
So what happened to them? Why do they no longer make TV shows?
They got gobbled up by Fox, who got gobbled up by Disney.
Oh, that's right. I forgot that we live in the world of omni-consumer products now.
But you know what that means? Disney owns Carlton, Your Doorman.
Oh, so when are they going to let it out of the vault?
Yeah, when are we going to see, you know, a live action high budget remake of Carlton, Your Doorman with all celebrity voices?
Damn. Now, of course, that's never going to happen. Disney has put it on complete lockdown. They've stuck it, you know, in that like, you know, the eighth sub basement right between Song of the South and Eek the Cat, and we will never, ever see it.
Other things we'll probably never, ever see. Bailey Kipper's POV.
What?
That was a Saturday morning live-action show about a kid who had cameras all over his household and was always, and it was kind of getting kids used to the idea of the surveillance state, really.
Oh, cool, cool. It's yes. Like, hey, it's like, You remember Elf on the Shelf? Well, get ready for Hellscape Panopticon. Man, that is a weird concept for a show, but maybe we're like home cameras like really big at the time. They're like, oh, this hot new technology kids love.
From 1996. Wow. Huh.
It's like how later when they were like, oh, we're going to make iCarly because to cash in on that whole iPod craze.
What was really weird about Bailey Kipper was that do you know what do you remember what Kai Power Goo is?
Yes.
They were doing that constantly on Bailey Kipper. Bailey Kipper would, he would smile at you, and then his, you know, smile would extend past his eyeballs.
Okay, interesting. It sounds like they were trying to go for kind of a Pete and Pete or a Beans Baxter feel for the show then?
Yeah, kind of. I mean, I only ever saw one episode, but it was really, it stuck with me because it's just so weird.
Yeah.
And it's never been on DVD or anything, so.
Man, that's weird. I guess just another one of those things that's going to, that's what happens when all media is owned by, you know.
Did you just say Beans Baxter?
Yeah. Do you remember Beans Baxter?
I just saw it listed as one of the first things made by Fox Entertainment.
So. Oh, what do you know? I believe it was an early Savage Steve Holland joint.
Yeah. So everything he's ever done is now owned by the Disney company, isn't
it? God damn it. I remember Beans Baxter from when I was a kid because there's an episode where Kit Navidad plays the Pumpkin Princess and she's got huge titties. And when I was 13, I was like, oh, that's interesting.
Yes. Here's the episode. Nightmare on Beans Street. Beans and his friends are set upon by a deadly pumpkin sent by Ugly's leader, Mr. Sue, and the Pumpkin Princess.
It's a good episode. I mean, apart from Kitten Navidad or Natividad or however you say her name. So speaking of kittens, kittens. Speaking of kittens, there's something else I should mention. I think we should mention, though, is our main man for this episode, Garfield, a.k.a. Lorenzo Music. And we talked because I think everyone knows him as Garfield. And of course, as Peter Venkman from The Real Ghostbusters. Mm-hmm. And of course, as Carlton, your doorman.
Yes.
But I was looking at his life, and he has been in it's interesting that those are kind of anomalies for what he's done, because almost every other thing he's voiced, because Garfield and Peter Venkman are kind of like, you know, kind of like smarmy, you know, sarcastic, you know, kind of goofy con men sort, almost not super in Garfield's case, but you know, he's a little bit sly. Most of his other things that he has voiced are much more like Tummy Gummy.
Kind of dopey and sweet natured. And, for the most part.
Yeah. Which is interesting that like his most famous roles are kind of the ones that are very unlike anything else he's done. But also I just found out, his name was not actually Lorenzo.
No.
He was born Gerald. And he changed his name to Lorenzo for spiritual reasons after he became a member of the International Spirit Association, Sabud.
Lorenzo, Sabud. I mean, a man has a right to change his name. So that's okay. You can change your name to Lorenzo and you don't have to explain it to me.
Yeah. I just found that interesting. It was like, so apparently Sabud is an acronym of Susila Budi Dharma, which is an international spiritual movement that began in Indonesia in the 1920s. So I learned something. I had not heard about that, but apparently because of his very strong faith in Sabud, Lorenzo Music frequently volunteered at a suicide hotline.
Oh, wow.
And apparently he says that like very often people would call in and be like, oh, I'm so depressed. My, you know, everything's terrible. Wait a minute. You sound like that cat on TV.
Well, I mean, that's pretty cool, isn't it?
I mean, it's nice. It's good that he, you know, it's always nice when you hear about a celebrity who, you know, gives back a little bit.
Little bit reminded of the story of how Penn Jillette did a episode of Miami Vice where he was playing a Colombian drug dealer of all things.
I've seen that one.
Yes. And so a few weeks after it aired, he was in New York and he decided to go to Sex World, which is one of these places where you could put a coin in and a door slides open to reveal what the live woman inside is doing.
Again, a remnant of a pre 24/7 pornography world.
Yeah. So he puts a quarter in, he looks at the woman, and she happens to glance at him, and she goes, "Oh my God, are you the guy from Miami Vice?" Clang.
Oh, I can't. I would be like, "Well, yes, I am."
Yeah, he said, "I could have put another quarter and said, yep, but I felt like it should have been her quarter. She wanted to see me."
Oh, he's like, "Oh, he's not going to do it. Oh, he's not going to perform for a fan? What a dickbag." Because I'd be like, "Oh, are you a fan of my work? Well, thank you."
Fucking libertarian.
Typical. Typical. You know, he's like, that exactly. So let's see. There's one other thing that I wanted to mention about Lorenzo Music. And that is, apparently, I could not find this because I was looking up other things he had done. Apparently, he was the spokesperson for Ruggles Ice Cream.
Ruggles?
Yes. And first of all, imagine that you're going to start an ice cream. And what are you going to call it? You're going to call it Ruggles.
Ruggles?
I can only assume...
Made with real rug scrapings.
Yeah. Like, I can only imagine it must be the name of the founder, because what other reason would you name an ice cream company Ruggles? It sounds to me like... I mean, it sounds like the name... It sounds like a Saturday morning cartoon series rather than an ice cream. But anyway, I could not find any of the commercials that he actually appeared in. Though I did find a whole bunch with the Ruggles jingle, which is apparently goes, "Scoop, scoop, yum, yum, Ruggles ice cream premium," which, I mean, it rhymes, so.
Apparently Ruggles is an unincorporated community in Ohio.
Huh, okay. Interesting. I wonder if that's where it's from.
Yeah. Oh, the name was most likely ultimately derived from Alman Ruggles, a pioneer settler.
Oh.
So I see. So the ice cream is named after his recipe that uses root marm.
I'm hungry already. man, also, apparently, again with Lorenzo Music, that Carlton the Doorman was so popular that he actually released a single.
He released a single about Carlton your Doorman?
Yes. It was a song called "Who Is It?" with where I guess they're singing "Who is it? Who is it?" and then Carlton does a spoken word rap over it, where he's all like, "I'm Carlton, your doorman. I'm here to say I love killing dogs in a major way."
that was the thing then. I remember it when, you know, if you had a popular character, then you just release a novelty song about it, you know, based around their catchphrase. Oh, like the one we talked about earlier, Pencil Neck Geek.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And whoever it was that was on Car 54, who was also on the Help, It's the Hair Bear Bunch.
Oh,
the guy whose whole thing was that he was like, "Ooh, ooh, ooh." And he had a whole song about going, "Ooh, ooh."
People love that. They love that "ooh, ooh." Can't get enough of that "ooh, ooh."
That should have been the name of the song, but no. Sadly.
Oh, what was it?
It was called "Ooh, ooh."
Huh. Okay. Why not? What a weird world. But yeah, so I guess he was popular enough that they had the song, but not popular enough that his cartoon series could go anywhere.
Well, Carlton, we didn't need you. Maybe we could have just opened the door ourselves. Did you ever think of that?
Yeah. Well, you know what? I mean, it's keeping him off the street.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he could be helping his mom side by side. They could be finding both boots instead of just one.
I think that's a good place to start cutting. All right.